This is the second video in a two-part series on how to grow a large single crystal. In the first video, we showed you how to grow a seed crystal. The second video is going to show you how to turn this seed crystal into a large single crystal. And so what are we looking for in a large single crystal? Well, we want large flat faces, sharp edges, and we'd like the crystal to be sort of as see-through as possible. And we also want it to be a single crystal, just one crystal, and that's what we have here. To turn our seed crystal into a large single crystal, we need to place our seed crystal in an alum solution. As the water evaporates, the alum needs to come out of solution. And if our seed crystal is present, the alum will stick onto that seed and cause the seed to grow. Now, there are a lot of different ways to put a seed crystal in a solution of alum. I like to use a fishing line. Here we have 0.3 millimeter fishing line. You can pick this up at any sporting goods store or craft store. Now, you may have seen in some of my other videos that I tried to glue the fishing line to a crystal, and it didn't really work out so well. So my preferred method is tying, and the way that I do this is I actually get my string and I tie a slip knot. If you're not sure what a slip knot is, search the web and find out. But basically, it's a nice little loop that's going to grab onto whatever you put in the middle. So we have our slip knot and we have our seed crystal. We can just sort of fish our slip knot onto the seed crystal. There we are. Come on, you. And there we have it. We have our crystal securely fastened to the string, but we have this little extra piece of string. We can go ahead and grab a pair of scissors and just carefully snip that away. And now we have a crystal that's ready to be submerged in a saturated solution of alum. So it's actually a good idea to prepare a few seed crystals because we'll be taking these seed crystals and putting them into a solution of alum, and a lot can go wrong. And so you may need a backup seed crystal, and I'll get more into the details a little bit later. You may remember from our last video that we harvested seed crystals from our large flat dish. We don't want to put the seed crystals back in here because, as you see, there's lots of other crystals around. We want to heat this solution up to get all of these crystals to dissolve. And so to do that, in this case, we're going to want to transfer it to a container that is suitable for heating. So we just carefully pour this in, and this is again where a squirt bottle can come in handy to help rinse some of these little crystals in there. Now, I'm not going to spend 20 minutes getting all those little crystals out, but I recommend that you do. Now, we've added a little bit more water back in here through the process of cleaning our dish, but how much water do we want, should we have? The short answer is we definitely want less water than that. This blue line indicated the amount of water that we used to initially grow the seed crystal, and the idea is if we put that much water back in here, it's just going to redissolve our seed crystal. So we want a little bit less water than that. But exactly how much? That's something you'll have to experiment. Too much water and the seed crystal is going to dissolve. If there was too little water, the alum is going to want to crystallize out incredibly rapidly and could potentially destroy the seed crystal. So you want just a little bit less water than you started with for your seed. So we'll go ahead and take our container, put it on the hot plate, and let this start heating. If you have a lot of solid material down there, you might consider stirring this, but in our case, we're not gonna, there's not much left, so we'll be fine without a stir bar. We want to get an ideal crystal shape, and the reason we suspend the crystal in the solution is because if a crystal grows against the in the bottom of a dish or against a surface, you're not allowing the crystal to grow equally in all directions, and that's what can give rise to some of the irregularities here. These crystals likely grew on the bottom of the dish. Again, when the crystal grows against a surface, the crystal can't really grow in that direction, and so you wind up with generally very odd-shaped crystals. When the crystal is suspended in the middle of the solution, all of the directions of the crystals have the ability to grow, and very often that will lead to crystals with the ideal crystal shape. So one of the things that can go wrong is adding your seed crystal to a warm alum solution. Now, if the solution of alum is warm, it's almost certainly going to dissolve your seed crystal, and that's what you'll see here. So here is our cooled alum solution to which we want to add our seed crystal. Now, how do we suspend the seed crystal in the alum? I like to use some sort of an irregularly shaped long thin object. If you use something round like a pen or a glass rod, it can roll around. Using something flat helps hold this in place. And so what we'll do is we just attach our seed crystal to this whatever object you want to use. Take a little piece of tape and tape it in place. Cut off the excess string. And here we go. We're ready to submerge our crystal. Now here we can see it's hitting the bottom. We don't want the crystal on the bottom of the dish. We want to raise it up a little bit. And so that's the nice thing about this cutesy little trick. We can just rotate this knife a couple turns. It lifts the crystal up, and now the crystal is suspended midway in the solution, and this is exactly what we're looking for. There's no other crystals around, so now any crystals, any alum that wants to crystallize out of solution is going to be preferentially attracted to the seed, and the seed is going to grow. Crystals like to grow in an area where they're not going to be disturbed. Ideally, this will be a dark cabinet, right? It'll be dark, there's no light, it's going to be free of air currents. And one thing you might consider doing is actually setting this on a nice piece of styrofoam to help not only thermally insulate it, but also to potentially free it from vibrations that could cause unwanted crystallization. So we'll go ahead and put this in a dark cabinet. So here we have an example of a crystal that I've been growing for about a week or so. It started out exactly like this, a single crystal in a beaker without any other crystallites. But here, a week later, we can see that not only has our seed crystal grown, but now we have a bunch of other crystallites all around the beaker. The trouble is, these extra little crystallites are alum crystals that are growing, and they're going to take away from the maximum size that your seed crystal can achieve. So how do we get rid of these parasitic little crystals? What we're going to want to do is pull our crystal out of solution, reheat the solution, and let it cool, and then put our crystal back in. The first step is to pull the crystal out of solution, and like I mentioned last time, you're going to want to squirt this off to prevent any possible little crusties from forming on the surface of the crystal. And we'll just go ahead and set this to the side. So we have our solution. We're going to put it on a hot plate. And this is where we're gonna wanna pay attention to our blue line again. So once again, the amount of water is critical. This blue line represents the amount of water that was present when I first introduced the seed crystal. We're gonna wanna add back in some water to this solution, but not quite to the blue line. The reason you want to add a little bit of water back into this solution is we have a lot of extra alum at the bottom. If we didn't add any more water, when this solution cooled back down, all of this alum would want to rapidly come out of solution, and it'd be like a snow globe. There would be alum powder everywhere, and it could really jeopardize the appearance of our seed crystal. Now we're just going to heat this up until all of these crystals dissolve. We're gonna let this solution cool back down, and once the solution is returned to room temperature, we'll reintroduce our seed crystal. Okay, we have our cooled solution. And again, the liquid is a little bit lower than our original blue line, and so we can go ahead and add back in our nice alum crystal. Now, at this point, I'm going to take my trusty marker and add a new blue line. The second blue line is a convenient reference point because as we let this crystal sit, water's going to evaporate, and at some point we're going to get more of those little parasitic crystals that we need to get rid of. We're going to have to remove the crystal, reheat the solution, add back in a bit more water, and again, we'll know how much water to add because of our second little blue line. So now we're going to take our crystal and put it back in our dark cabinet and let it grow until we start to see more of those parasitic crystals, and we'll have to go through another round of removing the crystal and heating. Now, this is something that you may have to do 3, 4, or 5 times. You basically are going to have to do this every time you see a lot of little extra crystals growing in your beaker. But every time you do this, there's a chance that something can get messed up and you'll destroy your single crystal. So you want to do it as few times as possible, but inevitably you're going to have to do this. But for now, into the dark cabinet it goes. Once you have your large crystal going and you've been through maybe 1 or 2 cycles of heat, you know, removing and heating to get rid of parasitic crystals, it's probably a good idea to take any of the leftover seed crystals that you have and toss them in there when you do another heating cycle so that you make sure you have all 100 grams of alum at play in the beaker. So that concludes our 2-part series on how to grow a large single crystal. In a few weeks, with any luck, this crystal will turn into a crystal worthy of winning the US crystal growing competition. Thanks for watching. Good luck with the crystal growth.